Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. We've no apologies received this morning, and the first agenda item is to agree whether to take item three in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The next agenda item is consideration of the spending priorities in the justice sector for 2022 to 2023, focusing today on the Crown Office and then the Prison Service. And I refer members to papers 1 to 3. And I welcome this morning our first panel of witnesses, who I'm delighted to see in person. So welcome Dorothy Bain QC, a Lord Advocate, and Mr David Harvey, Crown Agent of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and we very much appreciate you taking time to join us this morning. So I thank all the witnesses for their written submissions, and these are available online, and I intend to allow around about an hour and 15 minutes for questions and discussion. So please can I ask members to indicate which witness you're directing your remarks to, and I'd like to invite the Lord Advocate to make a short opening statement, and I'll ask the Crown Agent after that if he has anything that he wishes to add. Lord Advocate.
Thank you for inviting me to give evidence and for permitting me to give some opening remarks, conscious as I am that this is my first appearance before the committee as Lord Advocate. I very much look forward to working with all of you during this session of the Parliament and my period in office. I'm here with the Crown Agent, who is the Chief Executive and Accountable Officer of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. And I should say at the outset that day in and day out, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service staff fulfil their responsibilities to prosecute crime and investigate sudden, unexpected and suspicious deaths, and they do so rigorously, fairly and effectively. I take a realistic view of the pressures on public sector funding. The substantial increase in this year's budget was most welcome and is sufficient for the normal level of casework based on pre-pandemic levels. It also enables the pay of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service staff to reach parity with colleagues in other government departments. The biggest challenge to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has faced in the current financial year has been to recruit and fill the planned increases to the staffing complement, but we expect to reach full complement by the end of 2021-2022. The challenges that the pandemic has presented and continues to present to the criminal justice system are unprecedented. I am grateful that the criminal justice system was collectively provided with additional funding to begin to tackle the backlog in trials without affecting our operational activity. It is important that that recovery funding is sustained. The Crown Agent and I will be happy to elaborate on the services plans during this evidence session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lord Advocate. Mr. Harvey, anything to add?
No, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. So, on the back of your statement, Lord Advocate, I would just like to open up some questioning. Firstly, I would like to look at the issue that you raised in relation to recruitment. So, in your statement and your previous submissions, the issue of sort of casework complexity has been raised. So, for example, we know that the High Court is now dealing with around about 70% serious sexual offences cases, serious and organised crime cases, and also the number of petitions in terms of homicide cases has increased by around about 31% in the last financial year. And you've helpfully set out your plans around sort of recruitment and increasing your overall staff numbers both this morning and in your previous submissions. But I'd like to ask for a wee bit more detail around this, particularly given the growing specialist nature of casework and indeed the high tariff nature of cases that are being dealt with. And looking at the challenges from a budgetary context, that you might face in that wider context of recruitment, particularly in the sort of short to medium term?
So the main challenge that the Crown Office has faced in the current financial year has been to recruit sufficiently suitably skilled and qualified staff, particularly at entry-level legal staff and IT staff grade. It is a challenge to increase the staffing complement so significantly in a very short period of time, but the news is that we are making good progress. And as I pointed out, in spite of the challenges, we expect to reach a full complement by the end of 2021-2022 financial year. Insofar as I'm able to contribute further on that point and further in relation to the complexity and challenges of the casework, I think it's of assistance for the committee to understand that I personally was privileged to serve as an advocate deputy, a senior advocate deputy, the assistant principal advocate deputy, and then the principal advocate deputy in the period of 2002 to 2011 under Lord Advocates Boyd and Angelini. And during that time, I shared probably the most rewarding time of my professional career, working with the many talented lawyers and staff within the Crown Office and Procurative Fiscal Service, prosecuting many highly profiled and complex cases in the High Court and Court of Appeal. In that time, I grew to recognise the enormous contribution made by all of those in the service to the prosecution of crime at that level, not just from those working in administration and business management and human resources, but the very talented lawyers who are the custodians of the public interest and who work and have always worked in the highly specialised fields of specialist and serious casework, homicide and major crime in the High Court and local courts. And so that personal experience of mine at the level I prosecuted at demonstrated to me at that time that all of those within the service were committed to reaching the high levels of standards required for these very difficult and complex cases. And when I returned to Crown Office after 11 years of being in private practice at the bar, I have to say that I found that all of that I had experienced through working with the staff and the lawyers in the Crown Office and Procurative Fiscal Service just simply hadn't changed. They demonstrated the same commitment, the same dedication, the same desire to strive to improve. And so, yes, there are profound challenges. Yes, the recruitment is difficult, but I see that the way that we're progressing is in the right direction, and we will achieve what's necessary in the way in which we prosecute these cases outlined by the convener to the committee.
Thank you very much for that. That's very helpful. Sticking with the issue of around recruitment and prosecution being a career choice for many. I'm interested in some of the comments that Fiona Eady from the FDA Union made in her submission, just in relation to the way in which sort of more experienced staff have a role, an important role in mentoring, supervising sort of younger, less experienced solicitors or PFs that are coming through the system. Now, that's not obviously solely an issue for the court system, but nonetheless, I'm quite interested in what impact and what you see as being perhaps priorities within that context of mentoring and supervision so that younger, less experienced staff are able to learn on the job and build up their own experience, but at the same time allowing more experienced and senior staff to manage their own casework while obviously fulfilling an important mentoring and supervision role. So I'm trying to sort of look at this from a budgetary context, and I'd be interested in what you see as options within the court system in making that balance fit as well as possible.
Yes, so I can comment from my position as Lord Advocate, but perhaps the fine detail, Convener, that you're looking for can be contributed to by the Crown Agent. Mm-hmm. I think at a high level, what I would say is that as a prosecutor, I'm determined to drive excellence in all Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal casework. And I see as critical to that the appropriate level of training provided to the lawyers that come to the service. It is in the public interest that we have well-trained lawyers, that cases are well-prepared and are well-presented in court. There's no doubt that the recruitment drive brings an enormous pressure in that regard, and it has to be through the dedication of those who have committed their professional life to the service that we bring through young people to inspire them and to promote them to view the work in the same way that all those dedicated servants within this Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service currently do. So at a high level, I see training and education as critical to the improvement of the service. How we develop that in terms of the level you're looking at, Convener, perhaps the Crown Agent could give you a little bit more detail, but I recognise absolutely the strength in what Fiona Eady has said from the FDA.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, to pick up on that point, I too recognise the point that Fiona Eady is making, that staff have shown extraordinary resilience over this period and will continue to do so as we transition into a larger organisation with new recruits. That presents a challenge, but it's a welcome challenge to have the opportunity to bring on new, enthusiastic, skilled people. And that, I know, is something that colleagues welcome, appreciating that does itself present a short-term challenge. We did recognise that as part of the exercise in terms of the recruitment, and we had a new learning and development strategy published earlier this year precisely to accommodate this very challenge. Our training generally, I think, is quite highly regarded across the profession, whether at trainee level or at more experienced levels with bespoke courses. Given the nature of the challenge and the volume of the training that's required, that has required a very particular approach, and not least because there is a variety of experience that's joining us. Some people, like myself, when I joined the service, had already gained some experience in prosecuting in front of jury courts. Others are coming from different parts of the profession and may not have appeared in court at all. So there's no one-size-fits-all. So one of the things that we've consciously done is have an induction policy that, insofar as possible, seek to tailor to the individual. There is quite a lot I could say about this, but perhaps for the benefit of time, I'd be very happy to share the strategy document with you if that was of interest to the committee, but happy to pick up any detailed questions as required.
Yeah, that would be helpful. We'd be grateful to receive that. Thank you for those responses. I'll hand over. I know there are some other members interested in just looking at some staffing issues, so I'll maybe hand over to Jamie Green first, and then Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Lord Advocate. Good morning, and thank you for attending this morning. And also, I think it's worth putting on record our thanks to the staff within the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal, who've worked under tremendously difficult circumstances to keep our judicial system operating fairly and justly. So it's worth putting on record. I just want to drill down a little bit into some of the comments made in your written submission, looking ahead and basically your asks of the government as we scrutinise the forthcoming budget. The third bullet point in your looking ahead section says that additional funding for court recovery must be sustained. It will take many years to remove the trial backlog. Could you give the committee an indication of the scale of the backlog, the potential time period that it may take to clear it, but more importantly, what analysis has been done by the Crown Office for the potential cost of clearing the backlog? Because clearly it will require an uplift, at the very least, of budget year on year, 17% last year. What percentage do you need this year to ensure that you're able to clear that backlog quickly, efficiently and fairly?
So thank you, Mr. Green, for your question. And I'll deal firstly with the backlog and what troubles me deeply about that. And then with the assistance of the Crown Agent, I will look at if we can provide you with a figure that you're looking for. We've given some figures about cases and backlogs in the submission, but just for me to say now, the backlog of cases and the timescale for recovery troubles me deeply. It impacts adversely on accused persons who are awaiting trial, victims and witnesses who are unable to obtain resolution, and also on the lawyers and staff working within the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. It delays justice for all, and consequently, individuals and communities do not obtain the protection of the law, which can be obtained from sentences of imprisonment, protective orders, court-imposed disqualifications. But for me, out of all of the difficulties and challenges presented, my acute concern relates to those highly vulnerable victims of serious gender-based violence, that is predominantly women and girls, whose cases are backed up in the system of prosecution and in the High Court, where these very serious cases are tried. Out of 1,934 cases post-indictment, currently 1,290 of these are cases of serious sexual violence, and currently, as at the end of September, 837 of these cases, that's a 57% increase since lockdown, are awaiting trial. Into this equation, I would add that there would be a significant increase in cases being indicted in the next 2 years. These cases of serious sexual violence make up 70% of the High Court work and 80 to 85% of cases that proceed to trial. The delays arising out of the backlog, therefore, predominantly and disproportionately affect women and children. My acute concern arises out of the fact that the crimes of sexual violence do require a distinct approach because of the nature of the crime and the impact on the victims, causing enormous harm and often resulting in life-enduring consequences for the victims. The work done by Lady Smith and the Childhood Sexual Abuse Inquiry demonstrates that to be so, and that is why it's recognised as a violation of women's human rights and a form of discrimination. That is why the World Health Organization states that violence against women, particularly intimate partner violence and sexual violence, is a major public and clinical health problem and a violation of women's human rights. It is rooted in and perpetuates gender inequalities. Essentially then, I consider that sexual crime is different to other forms of crime and requires a distinct response. Yet, the solution to this remains a political one. It is for the Scottish Parliament to recognise this issue and to determine whether there's an alternative to what is currently being done that does not impact on accused rights to a fair trial, but also recognises the scale of the impact on the rights of victims of gender-based sexual violence, and to determine whether there is another measure to recover and renew in these cases, whether there's an alternative way to proceeding as an interim measure. So, Mr. Green, the backlog is an enormous problem and the figures are within the submission we've given you. But for my purposes today, I wish to highlight the extraordinary numbers of sexual violence cases waiting for trial and the impact that this has on the most vulnerable members of our community and the most vulnerable members of society that require the protection of our courts. Insofar as the particular identifiable figure that we need to deal with the backlog, as I say, the Crown Agent might help. But I think it's also important to know and just to recognise that we have to work constructively with other people on the backlog. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has to work with the Scottish Court Service, the Law Society, Sheriff Principals and Senior Judiciary to operate the court programme in a way that tackles the backlog. But what we know, whether or not we have a precise number of years at this stage, is this: it's going to be multiple years to clear the backlog in the High Court, but more profoundly in terms of numbers in the Sheriff and Jury and local courts. So that's the high level response. I hope that you appreciate the reasons for that, and perhaps the Crown Agent could explain a little further.
First of all, Mr. Green, may I thank you for the words that you said in relation to colleagues in the service, which I wholeheartedly endorse. And picking up on the Lord Advocate's point, I would extend that personally to everyone else involved across the system. I have to say, speaking personally, In some ways, it's been a privilege over the last while during the pandemic, because people have risen to the challenge across all of the organisations, and I think the levels of collaboration and testing new ideas, etc., are an unprecedented level, and I include Law Society and faculty in that. And I'd like to go on record for thanking them today, given the first opportunity. Insofar as a local court is concerned, just to give you a sense of the impact of the pandemic, in terms of sheriff court trials, before the pandemic, there were 13,400 or thereby trials outstanding. The number at the moment is over 32,400. In the JP court, it was just over 3,200, and it's now sitting at 7,890 or thereby. And in the Sheriff and Jury Court, which Lord Advocate referred to as a particular pinch point, and I agree with that, there were around 1,330 pre-pandemic, and currently there are in excess of 3,500. If I can be clear about one other point about this before I touch on the recovery plan, that caseload was not plateauing going into the pandemic. It was already rising quite significantly, particularly in the solemn courts. Not so much in the summary courts, but in the solemn courts, it was rising really very significantly in the years leading up to the pandemic. So there are two challenges, as if the pandemic challenge wasn't enough. There is the impact in terms of the backlog that has been created by the pandemic, but there was an underlying issue beforehand that is still there in relation to a serious offending that demerits petition. And that's both at Sheriff and Jury and at High Court. And you've heard the Lord Advocate in terms of the disproportionate impact that has on women and girls, where it really is eye-watering in terms of the percentages involved in the High Court. So that's the nature of the challenge. I'm very conscious that you asked a finance question. And so in terms of nuts and bolts, in terms of the recovery programme, as currently agreed, enables four additional High Court trial courts, two additional Sheriff and Jury courts, and 10 additional summary trials courts. A pot of money was made available across the system to support that. We secured £7 million of that pot, but to be clear, that was part-year funding, because there was an assumption, as has been proven to be the case, that we would have to recruit, train, and then be able to populate those courts. And so the full year cost of that, not accounting for inflation and the issues of pay parity, which we can come on to as well, the full year equivalent of that £7 million is £12 million, before you then add any issues of inflation or pay parity to it. So if that's a helpful figure just now for current purposes.
Thank you. And I'll forgive the lengthy answers, because I think it was a high-level question in a sense, and you've touched on the important issue of that we are talking about budget and numbers and finance, but behind that lies people, and you make those points eloquently today. And those are areas that the committee, I know, will be discussing in more detail as we go on. But the numbers are important too, because it sounds like that's an extremely worrying situation in terms of the backlog. It sounds a little bit like a perfect storm almost that's facing you, because you had rising number of cases before COVID. The pandemic clearly has added to those challenges. And rising levels of vacancies and struggling to recruit, to fulfil posts, given the time lag that is required to take new entrants into the profession and train them to levels to manage those very complex, increasingly complex cases. So I wanted to ask about that. The biggest cost perhaps to you at the moment will be people and places. And on that, your vacancy rate is currently 12.8%. You stated that that will be down to 0.2% by March 22. That's only 5 months away. I mean, how realistic do you think that will be? And again, coming back to numbers, what will it take to get that 12.8% down to practically nothing, which is what you're forecasting.
I'm just conscious that this is a really important discussion, but we've got quite a lot of themes that we'd like to work through, so if we can keep answers and questions as succinct as possible, I'd be grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I think that Mr Green indicated this is a very important issue. I've made my point about the backlog, and I think in terms of the fine details, in terms of numbers, figures, the Crown Agent can come back on them. I appreciate the point that you make.
So I'll try to be as brief as possible. We've got a fairly high degree of confidence in those predictions. We have offers out with individuals that we're confident the numbers drop down quite significantly before Christmas. One of the issues is just the time it takes to do security checks, et cetera, as well. So actually, we have a fairly high degree of confidence that we're about to have another step change. And then over the course of the start of the next financial year, there's still a challenge, but it's a significantly smaller challenge. I'm perhaps happy to, given the time, to follow up in writing with a bit more detail, if that would help.
That would be very helpful. And I guess this is your opportunity to make your ask of the government, because the committee will present back to the government the findings of our pre-budget scrutiny, and if we know what we're asking for, then it makes life easier. So you're welcome to follow that up in writing. I guess one area that would jump out at me of slight concern is that if you're making a large number of offers to junior solicitors or people to come and join the Crown Office of Procurator Fiscal, that may be ringing alarm bells in other sectors of the legal sector. And I wanted to ask you about what average salaries were in the Crown Office and the PF in comparison to, for example, the independent sector which you worked in previously. There is a general feeling that the public sector and governmental bodies are recruiting proactively and aggressively from other sectors where there's now shortages and they're really struggling to stay afloat. So it's great news that you're reducing your headcount vacancy rate. But is that coming at the expense of other areas of the legal sector?
Perhaps I can give a contribution from the position of someone who practised at the bar, and then the Crown Agent can give the detail in relation to those who are being recruited to serve as permanent legal staff within the service. So as an independent practitioner at the Scottish Bar, as a QC in practice, I was very fortunate in my later years of practice to earn significant sums of money, which came from having committed myself to my job for a long, long time, and I have to say, many hours and many unsociable hours of hard, hard work. So for me, talking personally, probably my rate of pay coming into Crown Office as an Advocate Deputy and then committing again to public service, my pay probably is a quarter of what I earned as an advocate in private practice. And that is the case for many of the people that we're recruiting from the bar to come in and serve as an advocate deputy, serving in the public interest and committing to public service, which I have to say is the most rewarding part of any lawyer's work. It does involve an enormous financial drop in terms of salary and a huge commitment in terms of time and emotional engagement. So the notion that those coming from the bar to serve as advocate deputies are earning far more is just quite wrong.
Noted.
I suppose one of the things I'd like committee members to take away, and this might sound trite, is that this is going to be a marathon. And that it's going to test the resilience of everybody across the system for years to come. It, in essence, is the professional challenge of their lifetimes. I'm hesitant about particular moments in time and comparisons, because from my perspective, it is absolutely essential to succeed in that marathon we have a healthy a successful defence bar for the duration of that challenge, And I don't regard the two things as mutually exclusive. On pay for COPFS staff, I think I mentioned the pay parity arrangements that are in place and they are contained in the letter. That put us, for the first time since I joined COPFS in the late 1990s, on parity with government lawyers. That's all it did. And that is something that we're seeking to implement over the course of 3 years, so we haven't achieved that yet. So we are in a position where we are able to offer a better package than we were historically. And historically, there have been times where it would have been possible for me to leave the prosecution service and earn considerably more on the defence side. There's a particular moment in time here, and as I say, I do commend to the committee that it's important that all parts of the system are in a healthy state. And so far as recruitment is concerned, we have done a little bit of work on it. The vast majority of the recruits that we have are not coming from defence practice directly. So about 40% are homegrown, our own trainees. We're the largest recruiter of trainees across Scotland, have been for some years. And so therefore that creates benefits at times such as this. In terms of the applications that we've had, I'm told that over the course of the last year, our HR colleagues have looked back and about a quarter of those who have been successful have identified themselves as coming from specifically a defence firm. About a third have come from other firms where it's perhaps mixed work, and the best part of 10% have actually been unemployed at the time, and some of them were former defence colleagues. So we have sought to and continue to recruit across a range of experience levels, which I think refers back to the first answer I gave to the convener about why we need bespoke responses. But I want to leave the committee with the thought that it really is something that we need a healthy profession across the board in order to be able to achieve the outcomes that I think everybody in the room wants to achieve when faced with a challenge such as this.
Indeed. I'll hand over to Colette Stevenson, bearing in mind we've covered this off quite an extent, and then I'll hand over to Pauline McNeill.
Yeah, I'll try and be succinct as possible, convener, and good morning to both of you. Given that the full-time equivalent staff numbers have increased over the years, and I believe it's now at 2,000 from your submissions, what, if any, significant difference has this made so far to your service? And I suppose as well, given what we've spoke about and, the pinch points and the challenges that you face with the caseload as well, will the Crown Office, will you need, a further, real-time increase in funding for staff costs in next year's budget?
So what I would say in relation to the wonderful fact that we have had an increase in staff is that we are being given the opportunity to prepare cases and to prosecute these in a way that we would like. It is in the public interest that cases are well prepared and prosecuted. And if you have more staff and you have more people working on the casework, then the outcome will be just that. So for me, it is wonderful to hear about and to experience the fact there's a greater level of staffing within the fiscal service, but also in addition to that, there has been an enormous recruitment drive in relation to the advocate deputy cohort, which has resulted in the ability again to provide greater preparation time for cases and hopefully then a greater standard of preparation and presentation at trial. In addition to that, it has allowed me, as a Lord Advocate for the first time, to appoint a Director of Training specifically to the Advocate Deputy Team, who are challenged day and daily in court to perform very difficult work in very pressing circumstances. So these opportunities allow us to serve the public interest better. Crown Agent can give you a little bit more specifics on the staffing within the service.
So if I can perhaps, and I'll try to be brief, but referring back to what I've said earlier, we were against a rising challenge in serious casework. And so when we talk about baseline and core funding in this submission to you, that's about the step change that was required in order to deal with that underlying trend and, in our view, meet what we regarded as reasonable levels of public expectation in relation to that underlying trend. We then face the challenge of the backlogs over and above that. And I've given you some indication of the scale of those challenges and the funding that is available to us to deal with that backlog element is the recovery funding. So what we have at the moment is an enormous number of cases live in the system, part of which would have been there anyway, regardless of the pandemic. We are midst recruiting in order to get ourselves to the staffing level that we believed would have been necessary to meet that underlying challenge and go beyond to then be able to deal with the recovery, and we're still in that process. So going back to the FDA submission, I entirely understand how that feels just now, because there are those two layers of challenge, and we're in the midst of recruiting in order to be able to deal with both of those challenges. And so that reasonable levels of public expectation, those levels of contact that we would want to have with victims and witnesses, the levels of support, etc., are things that we will continue to strive for, but against the reality of, what was it I said, three times as many sheriff summary cases, twice as many High Court cases, and best part of three times as many sheriff and jury cases. So there's a huge challenge to not only service those cases, but to improve the service in those cases is significant.
I think Crown Agent, as well, the fact that there's going to be essentially a 50% increase in indictments in the next 2 years also from the current level. So the cases to be indicted will increase from about 56 a month to about 100 a month.
It's perhaps helpful just to pick up on that. With the 10 sheriff summary courts, the latest SCTS prediction is probably 2025, 2026, similarly for High Court. For sheriff and jury, it's longer than that. And that's operating at this capacity. And so we will be indicting 100 cases a month into the High Court from the start of the next financial year is our prediction.
Okay, can I quickly just comment on that? And obviously, in light of the pandemic, there's obviously been online juries, if you like. How has that been financially? Has that been more of a challenge, more of a cost, or you touched upon your submission as well about like digital technology. How is that developing, and where do you stand, financially there as an initial outlay, with potential savings going forward? If you could maybe just flesh that out for me a wee bit, thanks.
So, insofar as the use of technology is concerned, the service is wholly committed to continue to play its part in modernising the justice system to provide a more efficient, effective response. And use of technology is seen as an important part in that. There are some digital solutions, such as custody processing or virtual trials, and currently these may seem more resource intensive, but they do look to be a way in which to improve matters, to improve the timescales for cases going through, and they would include the opportunity to make savings from, for example, reduced travel time, court downtime, and the challenges that often witnesses face in terms of attending court for cases. So certainly we see the digital work that's being done by the service as very important to progressing in the current situation of the pandemic. How the what the financing is over remote juries is concerned, I understand that that was probably a question you'd be better directing to the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. I think I'm right about that, Crown Agent.
So of the funding that was made available for the recovery during the current financial year, over half of it went to the funding of the remote jury centres.
Okay. But it's really important. I think the fundamental point I would make is that we've got to embrace the notion of virtual courts and addressing meaningfully the backlogs of cases. And to not do that would be a real failing. And I think we're being challenged probably earlier on than we might have expected because of what the pandemic's brought. But it is a very important part of the new recovery transition programme. Crown Agent, on the fine detail.
I'll try to be very brief. Much of digital transformation is funded by capital. We had 10 years of flat on capital. We've just recently had a welcome increase this year. But we have identified significant opportunities that could be made in terms of improvements across the system with investment. We're in the process of developing, along with Justice Partners, a digital evidence sharing capability across the system, a witness gateway and a defence agent system, and separately as part of the emergency legislation that was helpfully passed by this Parliament, we've had electronic service of court documentation, etc. There are several things in the emergency legislation that I would suggest that we don't ever want to return back to the previous model, and electronic service is one of those, just by way of example. And then I suppose in terms of, for example, other innovations, virtual custodies, there have been over 1,000 of those so far. One of the challenges we have at the moment is that it's operated as a hybrid system, which is almost more, in some ways, inefficient. There are some questions there about with piloting, etc., and further exploration to make sure that the processes are absolutely inscrutably fair, whether once we have an evaluation that might be something that could be further expanded.
Okay, thank you. I'll hand over to Pauline McNeill, and then I would like to move on to some questioning around violence against women and girls, and I'll bring Rona Mackay in. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Lord Advocate and Crown Agent. Can I begin? It's a follow-up from Jamie Green's question on PE and staffing, but wanted to begin by saying I fully acknowledge that it's long overdue for Crown Office staff to have parity with government lawyers. I go a wee bit back in this one, so I'm fully aware of the years that it's taken, so I'm really delighted about that. But my question relates to that because, as Crown Agent, you've said, the challenges of outstanding trials is a huge challenge. But I would have thought if all the parts of the system are not functioning as they should, then we've got a bigger problem, and you'll be aware of the boycott of court due to dispute on legal aid fees. In fact, I spoke to both the presidents of the Glasgow Bar Association and the Edinburgh Bar Association yesterday, and those lawyers are working 26 days consecutively over COP26. They are working over the three weekends. And as you rightly said, Lord Advocate, if you work at the hourly rate for lawyers in those circumstances, it's pretty low. And not to mention, as the committee have already heard, evidence that it's not exactly family friendly. So there's one part of the system that's clearly not working. I suppose my question is, do you think, Lord Advocate and Crown Agent, that there is a danger in the short form availability of suitably experienced defence lawyers, because we are losing good lawyers because of this dispute, because of this long overdue issue of legal leaves, might undermine efforts to improve criminal justice and obviously the challenge that you have before you, as you've outlined to the committee?
So thank you, Ms McNeill, for the question. My response would have to be understood from my position as head of the Prosecution Service, and the points that you've outlined would raise concern in any quarter. But from my perspective, what I would say is that it's important to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service that there is a well-functioning, well-served criminal defence bar in Scotland, because the rule of law requires it. It's essential that any system of prosecution of crime, that the rights of an accused person are properly protected, and that the accused person is properly represented at trial. So it's in all of our interests, the Crown's interests and the public interest, that there's a strong defence bar. And if there are issues in and around what they're paid and whether or not they can attract people to doing this important work, then that really is a matter for someone other than me. And perhaps your question would be better directed to those responsible for the legal aid fund, to the bar associations and the faculty of advocates and the solicitor advocates profession. But for me, I see that it's essential that we have a strong defence bar. It's essential in any well-functioning system.
Thank you very much.
If I may, I agree entirely in relation to what the Lord Advocate's just said in terms of how imperative it is that there is a healthy a defence bar, not just a functioning defence bar, a healthy defence bar. I think I touched on that earlier in terms of the challenge that we all face. I'm a solicitor advocate. I'm a member of the solicitor profession. I have been on the other side of the table defending clients in before I became a prosecutor. I am fully behind that it is absolutely essential for the proper administration of justice and effective rule of law in Scotland that there is a healthy defence bar. I think there's perhaps an opportunity through all of this, and we feel some way away from it just now. But going back to that point I was making about the challenge of professional career, I'm sure you'll be familiar, having had similar conversations, it's incredibly rewarding work, regardless of which side of the bar you're on in terms of I'm not talking financial rewarding, I'm talking about the contribution that you feel you're making to society. And I do think that there is, and I have spoken to senior leaders in the faculty and the Law Society about this, an opportunity, given that this is a marathon, and regrettably we're at the start of that marathon, to build towards encouraging young lawyers to join us in that challenge of a lifetime across the different parts of the profession, and appreciating that there are discussions to be had that are not for me in relation to how we ensure that everybody is brought along together with that. I would say for this committee and the role that you perform, there is something there about us all recognising that strategic challenge, and as you've said, making sure that all parts are in a position to move together. And encouraging others to join us.
We've just got less than half an hour left, so I'm going to move on to some questioning around violence in women, violence against women and girls, and I'll ask Rona Mackay to come in, and I'll hand back to Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener, and I will try to keep this brief. I did want to ask some questions around that, and also to thank you for speaking so passionately earlier about the subject and the unique nature of it, and I wholeheartedly agree with everything you said. So that being the case, you also said in your opening statement that you felt that funding was adequate for the normal level of cases based on pre-pandemic levels. Given that solemn cases of domestic abuse have gone up by 20% over since 2019, and the huge backlogs we've spoken about, do you think this is the time for something radical? And do you would you be in favour of a specialist court? And do you think you're going to have enough funding to cope with, you know, the extreme figures that you mentioned earlier?
So the first question is it time for a radical solution? I said at the beginning the solution remains a political one. And it's whether or not the Parliament is prepared to recognise the profound problems that we face in the prosecution of these very difficult cases because of the backlog, and the fact that it is a violation of a woman's human rights to be the subject of gender-based violence. And I think the words of the World Health Organization say it in that they say that it's a major public and clinical health problem, and it's rooted in and perpetuates gender inequality. So I do consider we need to take a radical step. And the Crown Agent was on the work of the review that was carried out by the Lord Justice Clerk, and the Lord Justice Clerk's review group made certain recommendations. One of them was for a pilot in relation to judge-led trials, and I support that recommendation. But insofar as what we're faced with now, what this committee understands now is that the question must be asked, is there another way? Is there another way now to recover and renew in these cases? Is there an alternative way of proceeding that is an interim measure given the pandemic? Is there another way? And if there is, we are morally obliged, I consider, to look at it.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Pauline McNeill, I'll bring you in.
Thank you very much. This is the continuation of Rona Mackay's question, and as she did, I want to commend very strong words you've given to the committee, and I agree there's a moral imperative for all of government and parliament to consider very carefully the disproportionate nature of gender-based violence on women, and as you and the Crown Agent have described, the delays which are unavoidable are going to impact very seriously. You're also right to say that it's a political matter, so a matter for us to consider. I'm interested in your opinion then as to the period of an interim judge-led trial, let's say, if that was legislated for. Are you thinking 1 year or 2 years? Do you have any sort of time in mind? I know probably it's quite hard to judge how long the backlog will take to clear, but it would be helpful just to tell the committee how long you think we'd need those arrangements, and then we could reassess the situation.
So thank you, Ms McNeill, and I know that you personally have committed a lot of the work that you've done as a politician to promoting these issues in relation to gender-based violence, and as has a number of members of the committee. I haven't actually analysed out the sort of timescales that you're talking about, but I think what's important to say is that it does require a detailed consideration. And within that, I think that there's a very interesting section of the Lord Justice Clerk's paper that relates to question of jury or non-jury trials and different models that are in existence across the Commonwealth and the European Union. These are issues that should be looked at before anybody could say it's likely to take X years or Y years in terms of recovery. I think what's important to recognise, though, is that there would be a shortening in the length of the trials if there were non-jury trials. So the period that the trial would take would be shorter. And the opportunity then to tackle the backlog would be there. What I think is also very important, though, for me to underline is that in saying what I do not in any way wish to impact on an accused person's right to a fair trial. Nobody more than me, in all the years that I've practiced as a lawyer, recognises the importance of that. But we have a different constitutional arrangement than that of the English. And the Article 6 right to a fair trial isn't constitutionally informed. The English have the Magna Carta, we don't. And what we know is that from jurisprudence, from case law, from the European Court of Human Rights, a non-jury, a judge-led trial, doesn't impact on an Article 6 right to fair trial, where an accused person has the right to representation and would be receiving the decision of the fact finder in terms of a written decision. So he or she would be given reasons for the conviction. So I think it's important that if there's to be a debate around this, it has to be a well-informed debate which recognises the competing legal rights of all those within the system. Fundamental to that is an accused's Article 6 rights, of course. But there are other rights that need to be considered, and those are the rights of the victims of crime. And as I say, in that respect then, the solution remains political, and timing in terms of how that would address the backlog is probably something for further inquiry and further examination, if indeed the parliamentarians were prepared to take that forward.
Thank you very much. I think, Jamie Green, you'd like to come in with something on this.
Thank you. We are steering away slightly from budget, but it's a deep philosophical conversation about how we manage these types of rising levels of crimes of this nature. But I don't think there's any disagreement that we all want to move to a more trauma-led approach to supporting the victims of these types of crimes. But are you saying that the political solution to this is one which needs to change simply because of the scale of the backlog and the lack of resource available to process it? Would that come therefore at the expense that we're making changes to the way that we prosecute and try people simply as a result of the situation we find ourselves in due to years of increasing levels of activity in cases? Because that wouldn't surely be the right way to have to make changes, nor the reason why we should be making changes to how we try people, given the effect it has on the rights of the accused and so on.
So I think my point that I make arises out of the backlog, because of what the backlog has created. That's where my point arises, that it has a disproportionate impact on women and children. It, insofar as the political solution is concerned, that is for parliamentarians. But, Mr Green, you suggest that what has been suggested is impactful on Article 6 rights. It's not. That's the point that I make, that we have to recognise all rights. And we're not asking for anybody's rights to be curtailed or impacted upon or defeated in any way. We're just looking for a solution that needs to be provided for these particular types of cases that require a distinct approach. And that is something that's recognised across a number of areas of the world, and indeed in the jurisprudence from the European Court of Human Rights. Crown Agent, I think it might be important for you to come back on a little bit more of what Mr Green said about it being financially driven.
So, It's not a question of finance, and I suppose that I'd just take a step back and refer to the comments made earlier about what was going on beforehand. And I think we've provided some statistics in relation to the increase in serious sexual offending that was happening before we went into the pandemic. I'd actually put out two challenges. The one Lord Advocate has put out, but there's also something actually fundamental here. Why is it 80% of our trials in the High Court are serious sexual offending? And part of that is at the sharp end in relation to those trials. But there's something far more profound about that as a society. And I can't imagine there's any dispute about that in this room. And I can't imagine anything that would be, frankly, easier to get behind in terms of anything that seeks to try and address that, whether that's from an educational point of view, because I talk about a marathon, not a sprint. I'm also interested in the cases that are coming in 5 years' time. I don't want 17 and 18-year-olds in 5 years' time to find themselves in the High Court. Can we start to cut that off? So there's a big debate. I'm conscious we're here about money, but there's a whole other issue here.
For the benefit of the record, I wasn't implying that the changes were financially led, merely asking, raising the question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Katie Clark, I think you'd like to come in, and then I'd like to move on, if I may, to looking at issues around organised crime, and I'll stay with you. Katie, I know that you're interested in asking some questions on that.
Thank you. And it was on drugs policy that I was going to ask in the budgetary implications. You made a statement to the Chamber recently in relation to Class A drugs, and last week we heard representations from a range of campaigners in relation to issues such as drug consumption rooms. So the first question I really have to ask is whether you agree with the repeated representations that have been given to us that there are no legal problems, if you like, with drugs consumption rooms within the current legislative framework. If you could perhaps outline the policy in relation to that, but also, you know, are there any budgetary implications in terms of some of the shifts in policy that we're seeing in relation to drugs policy? And then I perhaps can go on to the wider issues in relation to organised crime.
So I think that what's important to remember is the history behind drug consumption rooms. In June 2017, I think it was, the Lord Advocate was asked by Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership to confirm, by way of guidelines or letters of comfort or protocols or formal policy, that the Health Board, the Council, their staff and partner organisations who were considering providing drug consumption facilities wouldn't be prosecuted for a range of potential offences. And the then Lord Advocate did consider that proposal very carefully and reached the conclusion that the public interest objective in a consumption facility was a health rather than a justice one. However, in relation to what was asked of him in terms of prosecution, he concluded it wasn't possible to grant the request. The potential offences which may be committed in any particular consumption facility will depend on the individual scheme envisaged, the policies and processes within the individual scheme, and the actual behaviours of both the operators and the users. And so the Lord Advocate couldn't actually, as a matter of law, whether through policy or otherwise, decriminalise conduct which was by law criminal, nor could immunity from prosecution be granted in advance. Now, the question of prosecution of in the public interest is something different. And if indeed there is a proposal that's made for a drug consumption facility that is precise, detailed, specific, and underpinned by evidence and supported by those that would be responsible for policing such a facility and Police Scotland, and there's careful consideration in and around how these consumption rooms would impact on communities, then if that sort of planned use of drug consumption rooms is brought to the Lord Advocate as a very well set out proposal, then in terms of the undoubted crisis that we face in relation to the number of drugs deaths in Scotland, if it is in the public interest that there should be no prosecutions for those using drug consumption facilities with all the safeguards that are required to be in place, then that would require a fresh consideration by me as Lord Advocate. So I think it's important to see the distinction between what James Wolfe was asked and what could be asked. These are different things. So the question of what is in the public interest would be something that could be looked at again, but it would have to be looked at again in very careful circumstances where a very detailed set of proposals are brought and we're confident that they are based on sound evidence.
That's very helpful, thank you. And in terms of the budgetary issues, I mean, we know that organised crime is heavily involved both in drug supply but also in prostitution. And perhaps in terms of priorities, in terms of the Crown Office, could you outline how we better focus resource on tackling organised crime, specifically in relation to those spheres, but more generally?
Yes, so insofar as the high-level approach that I as Lord Advocate would wish to take in relation to serious and organised crime, is that that is a very serious issue that concerns me greatly, and the focus would be on robust prosecution. That is because of the damage that serious and organised crime does across the Scottish community, and the enormous impact that serious and organised crime has on all different types of offending, from environmental offending through to drug supply, through to more serious levels of violence and homicide. It impacts across the board. So what's important to me is that work is properly funded and that it's properly prosecuted and it's done so in the right way in the public interest. In terms of the budgetary commitment to that, I can come back to you with more precise detail on that, but perhaps Crown Agent, who's more familiar with this particular issue, would come in on the financing for that.
Very briefly, I'm conscious of time, but we have the most serious end in the High Court cases, a bespoke serious organised crime unit. And that's all they deal with is organised crime and counter-terrorism cases, and you'll have seen again that there have been some of those of late as well that are worthy of mention. That is something that we have seen again in terms of an increase. It forms a part of that High Court backlog that we were talking about. Often those are multiple accused cases. Multiple accused cases have been difficult to deal with during the pandemic, and it's only now that we're in a position where those can start to be put through the courts. And I suppose that it's one of those classic areas where improvement in technology improves investigative opportunity and then increases the caseload and the complexity of that caseload. So you've probably all read, for example, about the EncroChat cases, which was an international investigation in relation to a secure server that was based in France, used by a number of organised crime groups across the world. We've got 50 of those cases, 50 organised crime, all from that one investigation. And these are people who were using that advanced technology in order to communicate with each other. So it's again an indication of the nature of the challenge, and it's all part of that complexity and the need for resilience that we highlighted earlier.
Thank you very much. I'd like to move on now, if I may, to the issue around COVID deaths, and I'll bring in Russell Findlay to pick up on that.
Thank you. Good morning to both and welcome. I just want to begin by echoing my colleague Jamie Green's comments. Now, the level of backlog in terms of criminal cases is startling, and the figures you've provided today really bring that home. And there's perhaps a public perception that criminal cases is what you do in entirely or primarily, whereas you're also responsible for investigating a large number of deaths that are not homicide. The submission here refers to a year-on-year rise of just under 11,000 to just over 15,000, almost 16,000, and many of these will be COVID deaths. Now, I've read about a COVID investigation unit. I don't know if it's called that. I don't know if it's a standalone thing. And forgive me for my question being a bit woolly, perhaps. It's more to see if you could expand on the nature of that unit, the challenges, financial primarily, I guess, of this huge rise in numbers, and also whether does every COVID death merit the same type of investigation, or does it just depend on individual circumstances? I know that's erring away from finance, but I suppose it's all part of this financial cost of what COVID is bringing to the Crown.
So you're quite correct, Mr. Findlay, that COVID deaths are dealt with by a specialist part of the Scottish Fatalities Investigation Unit. And from the time of my appointment, I have been engaged closely with members of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service discussing the way in which we can appropriately deal with COVID deaths, because they arise in all sorts of different circumstances. They arise in the work environment, within the prison estate, within care homes, and within hospitals. And it is a very important area of our work and we need to get it right. So there is a dedicated unit looking at COVID deaths and working out protocols and policies that underpin how we deal with these cases so that we can apply the same sort of decision-making across the board when it comes to considering whether or not these cases will merit or not merit fatal accident inquiries, merit or not merit prosecutions and the like. So, yes, you're right to say there is a specialist unit that's specifically looking at COVID deaths and looking at all the issues that these raise within the responsibility that I have as Lord Advocate for the investigation of deaths, and including that, the responsibility I have to make sure that steps are taken, if deaths can be prevented, that these are taken as quickly as possible. So it's a very serious issue for us. It's something that we're taking a great interest in. The numbers are significant. The Crown Agent might want to focus a little bit more on the other aspect of your question, and the funding that we've got for that. But there is definitely, within the work that we've been doing to modernise the process in and around investigation of deaths, a specific focus on COVID deaths.
Not much I can really add to that in terms of detail. The reality is, as Lord Advocate has said, each investigation has to be assessed in its own merits and concluded accordingly, and a proportion of those, as we've touched on in other deaths investigations, will result in a fatal accident inquiry and or a prosecution. The team's assessment in relation to the capacity required is part of the core funding that we talked about earlier, it's something that needs to be regularly monitored, because obviously candidly, when putting in bids this time last year, you were looking at an assessment of what the death numbers might be, but they are, as you can see from the figures, very, very high in terms of the numbers that have been reported to us. It's a 50% increase in terms of deaths reported to us, it's fair to say that's something that we've had to review.
So it's perhaps also fair to say that the budget for dealing with this subunit or unit is based on the entire budget and what it requires to do its job. There's not really standalone figures on that.
Well, they have assessments about what their staffing requirements are. I think the point I'm trying to make is that because of the cycle of finance, there was a particular moment in time where we were asking about that. We're now better informed as to what that scale is perhaps the best way to put it.
Sure. Thank you. Is it okay to move on to just very, very quickly as well, a little bit more specific and mindful of the fact there are still ongoing matters in relation to the Rangers cases. But there's been a lot of speculation in the media about overall figures, and I'm not asking you to predict outcomes, but can you tell us just where we are right now in terms of payouts that have, you know, left and are no longer live?
Yes, yeah, so what I can say is that some cases have resolved, with some paid to the pursuers as of September 2021, totalling £35.3 million. Other cases do remain before the court, which, of course, you rightly say, Mr. Finlay, limits to what can be said today. There has been no impact on the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service budget as a result of the civil actions, and these were underwritten by the Scottish Government with in-year transfers to directly cover the cost of damages and expenses and settlements. In the wider context, the Crown is committed to further public accountability and the process of inquiry once all the litigation is concluded. But the cases that remain before the court and the amount of money associated with what these involve, I can't really go into at this stage. And I think you will also appreciate the extent to which I have personal knowledge of these cases is restricted because of my own personal recusal from the Rangers litigation because of my previous involvement as senior counsel for Duff and Phelps.
Sure.
But perhaps the Crown Agent can say a little bit more. Do you wish to say anything?
Unless you want to.
I'm not sure, so I think I can add, since the figure's been given.
It's a very specific question. The money that has gone out, the £35.3 million, I understand, in both those cases, there was an undertaking, a commitment, that the Crown would pay tax if it resulted in there being a tax liability for those litigants. Do you know if indeed that has happened? And if so, has that been paid yet? Or have they yet to know whether they are going to have a tax liability?
I'm not sure whether I can talk about an individual's tax affairs, but all I can say is that we haven't been asked for any additional funding at this stage. Need to address.
Thank you.
Do you want to carry on and just move on to fatal accident inquiries?
The fatal accident inquiry backlog is obviously as significant as the criminal backlog and the other deaths backlog. I just wonder, in terms of deaths in custody, there have been significant reports of what appears to be a rise in such cases. Have you seen any discernible rise in deaths in custody? And what are the budgetary implications for that?
So, insofar as a rise in deaths in custody are concerned, I'm not informed about whether or not there's been an actual increase. I'm not sure if that's within our submission. But
I have that information. I'll give it by reference to financial years. So 18-19, we had 36 reports. 19, 20, 30, and 20, 21, 46.
Increase.
So I suppose if you were to look at it between the financial year ending 2020 and the financial year ending 2021, the increase is over 50%.
Yeah, and these are financial year figures.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I don't have the current number in terms of the funds.
But it's part of your overall budget. You just have to deal with these. Yeah. Okay.
And it might help for you to understand that that in addition to the modernisation that the Crown Office undertook for FEIs starting in 2019, that has had a very significant impact on the age of the case that's going forward to a determination before an FEI. Within that work, there has been created a specialist unit that deals with deaths in custody, and deaths in custody are considered by a case management panel that is suitably expertise in understanding all the significant issues that relate to deaths in custody, from the nature of the vulnerability of the prisoners within the prison estate through to the suicide prevention strategies that are available and the mental health provision that's available within the prison estate. So there has been, because of the concern raised publicly about these and a natural concern within the organisation, that there is a real focus on these particular cases and a drive to ensure that we look properly at what underpins the difficulties associated with these figures for deaths in custody.
That's great. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Fulton McGarry, would you like to come in?
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Welcome to your position, Lord Advocate. I wanted to ask about post-mortems. I know that this has been a topical issue for you, and I know that previously there was issues with the toxicology departments, which was causing significant delays, but also there's been a more recent surge as well because of an increase in deaths. I'm wondering, in terms of the budget aspect of that, I'm wondering if the toxicology issues have been resolved, and in terms of any further delays, if you feel that the budget is currently sufficient to ensure that postmortems can be continue to be carried out as fast as possible.
Yes, so thank you, Mr. McGregor. And It is correct that there were the difficulties with toxicology analysis that you describe, but I think that I did answer in a parliamentary question recently, and indeed in a written answer to Jackie Bailey, that there was a very successful improvement plan applied to the backlog of the toxicology reports, and these are now completed within acceptable timescales. I think there was issues over the contracts that related to Glasgow University and the consequent impact of the delay in providing toxicology reports in terms of the ability to conclude post-mortem reports. So the toxicology issue has been resolved. The impact on post-mortem reports is yet to be absolutely resolved, because I think just as those who are dealing with these reports are dealing with new post-mortem reports, they're also dealing with the reports that have come as a result of the delayed toxicology. So there is a bit of a backlog with some of the post-mortem reports. But what is important to me is that this issue has been identified, it's been worked on, and it's being resolved. And what is important to me is that families of victims of homicide, their needs are understood and the import of this issue is being addressed, and nobody more than me understands the impact of delay in respect of these issues. So my focus is on what has been done to improve the matter and how we can take matters forward now. In terms of the budgetary provision, again, a Crown agent might be able to assist with that, but I don't think there's any significant issue over that, Crown agent.
I suppose what I would comment on is there's a live procurement exercise at the moment in relation to pathology. I think it's maybe a common misunderstanding. I think that we actually have to, in essence, contract for that work to suppliers, whether they're health service, university, etc., etc. And so that's happening at the moment. At the moment, we have contracts with 7 suppliers across the country. And as I say, that's being reviewed in 2 toxicology providers. So it's and I suppose the other point that is worth making again from a strategic level for interest for this committee is that there is an issue in and around the availability of pathologists, and that's not just Scotland, UK. It's further afield than that, and so there are some underlying issues here that impact on capacity beyond simply finance.
Okay, thanks for that. I think it was helpful to put that on the record. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we're just about coming to the end of our session this morning. I think Colette Stevenson, were you interested in asking about outturn figures? And then
I think it was highlighted upon within the audit that came out as well from Audit Scotland, and in terms of what your long-term strategic plans are and if there's a report in place outlining what that is, and if not, when will it be available?
I think this is one for the Crown Agent.
a strategic plan. So we have a strategic plan, but
so we have
a strategic plan, but I'm not entirely clear what in terms of outturns, but
in terms of the outturns. Sorry, it was more to do with your long-term strategic plan report.
It's fair to say that we have one, but it needs to be revisited in light of the challenge that we now face, and how we appreciate the scale of that is perhaps the best way of putting it. So that's and part of that will be informed by the outcome of this exercise.
Okay. Thank you.
I suppose our budget informs our strategy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. If there are no more questions at all, I'd just like to thank you both very much indeed for your time. Of course, if there are, if there's additional information that you'd be keen to share with the committee, we would be very keen to see that. So again, thank you both for your attendance here today, and we'll just have a short 5-minute break to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you again. Thank you. So welcome back, everyone. Thank you for rejoining the meeting. The next witnesses before us are Ms. Theresa Medhurst, the Interim Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service, and Mr. Gerry O'Donnell, Interim Director of Finance for the Scottish Prison Service. And I thank you both very much for attending and also for your written submissions. These are available online, and I intend to allow an hour and 15 minutes for questions and discussion. So I invite Theresa Medhurst to make a short opening statement.
Thank you. Good morning, convener and members of the committee. I welcome the opportunity to meet with you today alongside my colleague Gerry regarding the budget for the Scottish Prison Service for 2022-23. First of all, I would like to record my appreciation for the increase in the budget for this financial year that we received, and that was an increase of around 4.1% on both resource and capital. However, the Scottish Prison Service is a large and complex organisation, and whilst our primary purpose is to manage those individuals whom the courts place on remand or sentence, we do and must continue to do more than just hold people, something that becomes increasingly more challenging. Our understanding of risk and needs becomes ever more complex. The demands placed on our staff group also become more complex. These demands shift due to the changing makeup of our population, as well as the increased complexity of the differing population types. All of this is set against our physical constraints. Our estate is large, and a mixture of newer builds, being between 10 and 20 years old, through to our older Victorian-built prisons. As I'm sure the committee are aware, there is significant commitment of capital investment into our estate, which we welcome. I would also like to draw the committee's attention to the contracts that SPS manage. There are three large contracts, two of them private prisons, Addiewell and Kilmarnock, and of course the prisoner escort contract with Duamy, which we manage not only on our behalf, but on behalf of our partners. I'm sure the committee are in no doubt about the impact of COVID-19 across the justice sector, as you've just heard evidence from the Crown Agent and the Lord Advocate. And we have certainly experienced the complexities and added pressures brought about by that impact. Whilst it has brought challenges, though, it has also brought learning and new ways of working. We have had to operate through a public health lens in a way we would never have experienced previously. This has created a context which has raised awareness of and the need to ensure that we continue to seize the opportunities and benefits from ensuring a greater balance in our approach between managing risk and improving health outcomes. The pandemic and other societal factors has and will continue to impact on and shape our financial spend, requiring readjustments to our profiling and financial planning going forward, not least of which is the need to continue to invest in our staff, the estate, and the expansion of our digital capabilities. Finally, I would like to take the opportunity to record my thanks to all of my colleagues in the SPS, all of our partners, particularly our NHS colleagues, and other partners across the organisation for both their hard work and dedication throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you, convener, for the opportunity to provide an opening statement, and I look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you very much, Ms. Medhurst. I wonder if I can start off just looking at a little bit around staffing and recruitment. And a note in your opening statement there, you spoke about the demands on staff in particular arising from COVID, but also generally from your increased population within prisons and the different population types that you are caring for. So in terms of staffing and the challenges that you face arising from the likes of COVID, shortages of staff, issues around morale and incidences or increased incidences of violence that we're aware of. And we had a very, very helpful visit to HMP Edinburgh earlier on this year that really helped us sort of focus some thinking around staffing challenges. So in terms of recruitment and retention of staff, and bearing in mind this might not just apply to prison staff, but also to, for example, healthcare workers, I'm interested in just a little bit more commentary around the sort of short to medium term budgetary considerations that you will have to make in order to hopefully get to a point where working within the prison sector is ultimately a career of choice for many.
Thank you very much, convener. Multifaceted question, so I'll try and answer all parts of it. So I think at the height of the pandemic, when we went into the first lockdown, we did experience extreme pressures on our staff. And the reason for that was multifaceted. We had been in a position where we had not achieved our... We normally operate within a 1% tolerance level in terms of vacancy assumptions, and we hadn't been in a position to achieve that due to attrition rates the previous year, as well as some challenges around recruitment. However, and as I say, at the start of the pandemic, when we first went into lockdown, clearly people were very concerned for their health, and we did experience high levels of absence. I think there was a degree of confusion as well over, you know, who was in the shielding category, what that meant, etc., etc. So our absence levels at that point increased, and what that meant was that we needed to move into an operating model of a core day. We normally operate a two-shift system. So we moved into a core day, and that core day took on slightly different start and finishing times dependent on which establishment requirements needed to be met. So that move into the core day obviously placed different pressures on the staff group, because what it meant was we had to condense all of our legal requirements into a much shorter time frame. What did happen at that time as well was that due to the reduction and, well, the cessation of court business, it meant that our population did drop. So we did experience a drop in population pressure at that time. And since that period, if you like, so over the last year and a half, we have managed to make some changes which has allowed us to continue to recruit, but through an online platform, through so creating new digital capacity and capability, we were able to continue our recruitment activity. So we are now sitting round about our 1% tolerance level, which is greatly improved from where we were last year. We have also experienced a slowdown in the attrition rates. Now, it's difficult to see why that is, possibly because of you know, reduced opportunities during the pandemic, but people have chosen not to leave the organisation. In addition to that, our staff absence levels have fluctuated, I think is probably the best way to reflect the position. It definitely improved considerably, and it certainly hasn't reached the rates of absence that we experienced in 2019, for example, when there were real pressures on our population with increases over 2018 and 19. So the absence levels are monitored very, very carefully. We've also introduced a new staff absence policy at the beginning of April, which is much more focused on a person-centred approach and providing the right support and appropriate aids to individual members of staff to ensure they can come back to work. I think the organisation has felt almost as if it's been in two parts, though, because what we have is we have some parts of our organisation which are headquarters, our stores at Fald House and our college, where we have been able to do much more to enable remote working. So that has allowed a degree of flexibility that previously wasn't available, certainly to the extent and range that it is at the moment. And that flexibility has clearly ensured that staff feel that they have much more agency over their working arrangements. On the counter side, though, we have had a year and a half where our operational staff have been working a day shift rather than that two-shift system. And when you're used to working, you know, a back shift and an early shift, the monotony of a day shift we know has had an impact on staff. So that's where I would say there has been an issue, and that those individuals in particular who had lifestyle arrangements around that have obviously had it's had a detrimental effect on them. So we have worked in partnership with the trade union side, our trade union partners, all through the pandemic, and we brokered an agreement with them that we would try and move back to a two-shift system by the end of September, around the beginning of October. All but one establishment, possibly two, I think have managed to do so, but it has added additional pressures because we are still experiencing outbreaks. We're still in the middle of a pandemic, and therefore there are still some tensions around the staffing models that we've applied. However, where, and this has happened throughout the pandemic, where establishments have had significant increases in absence, particularly related to COVID and due to outbreaks, what we've been able to do is redeploy staff from other establishments in order to support them and ensure that we've had a safe operating model in place.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know if there's anything, Mr. O'Donnell, you would like to add to that. Just bearing in mind, I'm quite keen to keep the session on track around budget scrutiny.
One thing was, you mentioned all staff. We do have probably some recruitment issues in IT staff, you know, so there are specialist areas where it is challenging, but and obviously that may have a budgetary impact.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. We'll just stick with the issue around staffing, because I know some other members would like to come in on that. I'll maybe hand over to Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Mr. Finlay.
Yes, I mean, obviously drugs is a massive problem in the prison system. Can you maybe outline what you are doing in the current situation to tackle that problem? Obviously, there was a number of measures that were brought in during COVID around mail that have been referred to. Was that something that you think had a positive impact in terms of the drug situation? Or is there anything else you would point to in terms of initiatives that you're currently taking that are helping to address what's a massive challenge?
I think the Crown Agent referred earlier to the impact of serious organised crime, not just in relation to drugs, but certainly that success that has been achieved across other parts of the justice sector has meant that certainly for us there has been a rise in serious organised crime, and therefore the issues around drugs and drugs in prison becomes ever more dynamic and complex. So there are steps that we have taken and continue to take. So we look at the use of technology and how we can better deploy technology. So, for example, RapiScan machines were rolled out across all establishments last year after a period of piloting and testing in two or three establishments. At the forefront of the work that we are doing around the RapiScan machines, we are linked in with Dundee University, who are taking forward what's been described to me, but by the academic world. They are taking forward world-leading work around the issue of psychoactive substances in particular, the work that they are leading is around anticipating both the changes in the makeup of the substances that are coming into prisons, as well as helping us to understand the profile and where the drugs market is likely to go, by not just looking at what's happening in prisons in Scotland, but also looking across other jurisdictions as well. And that's certainly work that we are sharing with other jurisdictions, because it's not being done elsewhere, certainly in the UK. In addition to that, though, there are clearly more sophisticated methods that are developing, and that's why I said it is a very dynamic dynamic set of circumstances that we have to deal with. And so in addition to that, we work very closely with Police Scotland. They clearly are at the forefront of the tactical and response options around how they deal with it. Serious organised crime and drugs in particular, illicit drugs. So we work very closely with them to develop not just our profiling, but our tactical options to ensure that we are keeping up to date with changes in the scene. The other side of this, though, is obviously about helping people's recovery.
Maybe, if you don't mind, I'll maybe just pull the session back to looking at issues around staffing, and we will come back to drugs. Obviously, this is a really important issue, but it's just so that it allows us to keep the session on track. And if I may, I'll bring in Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, welcome to you both. The issue of absences, you've already touched on. Sickness levels, you say they are fluctuated, and indeed they've not reached 2019 levels. I'd also like to just begin by expressing appreciation and respect for the officers in your service who are doing an incredible job. I have heard from a number of them in the past few weeks, as you'll be aware. Some of them effectively become whistleblowers, and they talk about some significant levels of absences. It may well be that across the board we are not at levels that you have previously seen, but is it perhaps the case there are hotspots in particular establishments where there are high levels of absences?
Thank you very much for your question, Mr. Finlay. I think I alluded earlier to the fact that as we've moved back to the two-shift system, it has put pressures on our staffing profile within establishments, and we are acutely aware of that. And so where there are particular pressure points, where there are establishments who are identifying that they're not coping. So, for example, there are unique, I suppose, pressures in somewhere like Grampian because of the really buoyant job market up there. So we do have problems recruiting. So they have not moved back to a two-shift system because their staffing model wouldn't allow it. So where we can flex and change, then we will do so. But as I also alluded to earlier, where establishments indicate they are not able to meet the demands, then we will look to deploy from other establishments. And we've done that a number of times over the last year and a half.
So some establishments are back to the two-shift system?
Majority. I think there are only two at the moment that aren't. And yes.
OK. On a similar theme, the role of senior management has been suggested to me that many people in senior positions, including yourself, are either in interim posts or temporary or words to that effect. And this has further been suggested as causing perhaps some uncertainty with the staff, and some cynical perhaps suggestions that the reason for so many of these, if indeed there are so many, is perhaps to save money by not making people in permanent positions. Is that something you recognise?
I recognise the fact that, as you've pointed out quite rightly, Mr. Finlay, you know, I'm in an interim position and Gerry is as well. We do have a number of vacancies in senior leadership, not the numbers, I think something around about 19% to F-band, and it's smaller numbers as you move up the ranks. But We have continued to run campaigns throughout the period of the pandemic. So certainly from my perspective, we're running campaigns but we're not achieving resolution to those vacancies, then it's not the position that we are not trying to fill the vacancies. We clearly are trying to fill the vacancies. However, I think what the pandemic has done is allowed us to refocus where we want to be with regards to our leadership development. So we're about to relaunch our leadership development strategy because that required to be refreshed, and we are moving to an approach which is focused around development and development centres, which will be launched next year. So in the meantime, what is commencing this week is another series of recruitment campaigns, but we have amended and adjusted them to ensure that, particularly because of the pressures that people have been working under over the last year and a half, I think we need to take cognizance of that and make sure that those assessment procedures, whilst they are still fair and open, allow people to really bring through their experience in a way that's much more meaningful. So we've made some adjustments, and I am hopeful that between now and the end of this financial year that we will have all of those vacancies filled.
This has been filled. The nature of these large number of temporary or acting posts will
negate then. Sorry.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Right. There was one more thing I was going to touch up on, unless we want to come back to it. There's been much said about the introduction of the mobile phones and the cost to that. I don't have it off the top of my head, but there's £3 million, I think, or thereabouts. Now, I understand that the private prisons chose a different model, whereby they had phones that were attached to a wall and could be used communally, and have not, therefore, had the same security issues that we've seen with the model adopted elsewhere. Given that this money has been spent and these phones are in circulation, is there any discussion about perhaps phasing that out and moving towards the other, apparently more secure model?
Thank you very much, Mr. Finlay. I appreciate, again, your question, because there has been much said about mobile phones in prisons. And, I mean, we introduced the mobile phones last year. We were moving into uncharted waters, where we put down family visits for 2 days at Christmas and New Year. And apart from that, other than things like the Beast from the East, we tend not to stop visits for any period of time, certainly in my experience. So we were entering uncharted territory, and we understood and knew that communication was going to be incredibly important, not just for those in prison, but particularly for families and in particular for children. And at the start of the pandemic, when we were experiencing staffing difficulties, I know and I understand it was difficult for families to make contact with those in custody. So in normal times, we would not take, I think, what was about 4 months to introduce mobile phones into the prison service. But we were facing unprecedented challenges. And certainly from my perspective, to do so and to do so as successfully as we did was quite unprecedented for an organisation. And with that came very clear guidance from government around the security protocols. Now, we tied down those that we were aware of. There were others that have arisen subsequently that you have alluded to, which we are also now working to fix, because we do have a fix for that. The model that has been applied in Adderwell and Kilmarnock has been, they have been able to do so because of the infrastructure built into the establishments, and that has allowed them to come up with that hardwired solution that wouldn't have been possible for us in the timescales that we had available. To move to something like that would take considerable time and investment. However, we are looking at what should come next. One, to alleviate some of the difficulties that do exist with mobile phones, and two, to ensure that we have something that's more enduring going forward. But what I would just like to add is that with our mobile phones, there have been a considerable number of calls that have been made, and I'd like to look at my notes, but it is eye-watering, the number of calls that have been made to families and the contact that has been sustained during the period of time that the mobile phones have been in place. And certainly for me, in terms of reassuring those in custody that the measures we were applying were proportionate and in line with communities, then families were able to confirm that for them.
That's interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to move on now to looking at issues around the prison estate, and I'll bring in Jamie Green on that, and then I'll ask a couple of questions around that.
Thank you, Convener. I had two strands of questions, one on budget, pure budget, and the other on the prison estate. I'll maybe do the budget one first, perhaps stress that Mr O'Donnell. Just looking at the last three financial years, I just wanted to question why the planned budgets and the outturn figures are so starkly different. There seems to be an underspend of around £51 billion across 3 years. Is it the case that less has been spent than forecast or less than it is available to you as a budget? And if so, what is the reason for any underspend? What happens to it? Is it simply just not drawn down, or do you have to return it to the government?
Okay, so in answer to your first point, yes, that less has been spent, and it's the primary reason for our underspends is our capital programme. We have at the moment have a number of construction contracts across the estate, and which is probably unusual compared to like 5-6 years ago. So there is quite a large investment in the estate at the moment. And because of the delays, etc., the pandemic, we have had significant delays in these construction projects. So that's certainly the primary reason for the delay last year. And the previous year, it was also delays, maybe not specifically to the pandemic, but construction contracts. For the committee, I've just recently joined SPS. I'm coming from the construction industry. And you know, it can be very difficult in terms of going from the initial conception of a project to the handing over the keys to the building, etc. And there's inevitably delays, and that's what's happened primarily within SPS. Now, the information is we start off with a baseline budget each year, and at that during the year we then we'll have an opportunity discussion with Scottish Government to a revised budget, and at that point, yes, we would then say we are unable to spend X amount of capital, and that would be available across the government for other areas.
And presumably that therefore is capital underspend on new build projects that are going beyond their expected time scales. But we also know that those projects are also going over budget as well, if you look at the example of Inverness. Yeah. So that doesn't quite tally up. And surely that only relates to the capital budget on new build. If we go back to the issue of prison estates, or as we come on to the issue of prison estates, we know there is quite heavy underinvestment in that area, and I'll come on to some specifics on that. So why effectively are you saying to the government, we will be spending less than we forecast this year, when we know there are so many projects which are still require spending?
I think it's not something you can actually go out very quickly and get a product off the shelf, etc. These projects require planning. They require, it could be even planning permission, but planning the workload. There's a tendering process to go out, getting the contractor in place, etc. And as I say, yes, in the previous years, traditional maintenance type work has slipped, but that's because of you weren't able to, these organisations weren't able to work on the estate because of the pandemic. The team, and it's not just in terms of capital as well, the estate. It's other capital, is IT equipment as well. You know, we're investing. We're investing in that area as well, and we are indeed knowing that we will be having kind of slippage in projects. We are looking to bring under projects in line, so we are looking to minimise, as I say, the shortfalls on capital spending. And yes, it's happened. You know, there's been a couple of years where it's been significant kind of reductions in the kind of in the capital spend. But as I say, it's something that we're looking to address going forward.
Thank you for that explanation.
Can I just allow Ms. Medhurst to come in? I think you were quite keen to come in on that.
I was going to ask Ms. Medhurst my next question as well, so maybe you can, for the clarity of time. On budget, we're looking at budget scrutiny. We've had a number of written submissions about the SPS budget. The Howard League state specifically, and I quote, "It does not believe that the Scottish Government is providing enough budget for the work expected of the SPS. They're obviously a third sector organisation, but Her Majesty's Inspectorate for Prisons for Scotland specifically stated that it has seen no evidence to suggest that the SPS is sufficiently resourced to make adequate process with capital budgets, strategic investments and important but routine maintenance." To what extent do you agree or disagree with those submissions?
Okay, I'll answer that first, and then I'll maybe come back to the points you were making earlier. So, I think both the Howard League and the Chief Inspector of Prisons partially making reference to, the increase in population and the increased complexity of that population, and therefore the demands that are placed on us. We have been spending time looking at both our capacity and capability for programme delivery, for prisoner programmes, as well as the profile of those programmes because of the change in nature of risk of those individuals coming into care and coming into our care. So there is work that we have been, preparatory work, and we have started to reshape certainly our psychology service, as well as consider what the wider implications are going to be over our workforce. I think there will be increased demands. There was mention made earlier about being trauma-informed, and certainly in terms of the women's estate, I know that is going to come in at a significant cost in relation to having a bespoke trauma-informed service for women in custody under our reconfigured estate. But that obviously equally applies to men. So there will be a greater cost implication going forward, but a lot of that work is in its infancy. Secondly, in relation to the estate that the Chief Inspector makes reference to, the concentration, I think, certainly in previous years has been around the capital investment required to upgrade what are Victorian buildings. And clearly the replacement for Inverness, the women's estate, the replacement for Inverness and the replacement for Berlinney in particular, is a single point of failure for us as an organisation, so we need to ensure that we have replacement for that. It is an old building, it is old structures and infrastructure, and it carries the responsibility for the population flex across the whole of the estate when the population rises. So that is a critical point for us, which is why it was important that that was included in the infrastructure investment plan. I think, though, where the Chief Inspector's coming from is the other older estates. So we have carried out condition surveys on Greenock and Dumfries Prison, and we have already commenced work, upgrading work. Now that the remainder of the, I think there's further 2 years investment required to upgrade there, that will then go into our budgetary submissions to Scottish Government. The remainder of the estate, we are also going to undertake condition surveys on them, and clearly that will then inform not just the maintenance programme that we require going forward, but any major capital investment that's required for the rest of the estate.
And I'm glad you mentioned HMP Greenock. because that and Dumfries are probably the most criticised pieces of estate in the country. HMIP said that it is an establishment which is breaching the human rights guidelines on cell size, are expensive to maintain and have limited surge capacity. Are you therefore disappointed that the Programme for Government does not announce any new capital budget for the replacement of either HMPs Greenock or Dumfries? And what would your asks be of the government on that front?
So in relation to Greenock isn't in the five-year infrastructure investment plan, but there has been discussion around Greenock, and obviously we have the site for Greenock, so that is something clearly that we will work towards. Dumfries clearly needs to also be to come into our options in terms of what we do with HMP Dumfries in terms of replacement going forward, but clearly that is going to be dependent on capital resource coming to SPS from other parts of the public sector. So we will make our case, as others will do, around further investment for the remainder of the state.
How long does it take to build a new prison, roughly?
Depends on size. It depends on the design concept and the strategic intent. It also depends on the nature of the labour market and the other market factors. So the point I was going to come on to that in the question that you asked Gerry around the capital spend and some of the money that we've handed back has not just been capital but it's been maintenance, and some of that is that some of our contracts when we set them out for letting are not taken up. They're not attractive enough. When you bundle up contracts, that sometimes seems to be more attractive, but other times it's not. So the construction market in particular, I think, has been fluctuating over the last few years, and it's made it difficult at times to plan and prepare for some of the work that we need to have undertaken. And certainly there was a significant, the most significant underspend on capital was in 2021, and that definitely was due to the pandemic. But we are also experiencing a number of other pressures which will have consequences for this financial year and into future financial years. And those factors are things like supply chain. So it's societal factors that you'll be aware of, but supply chain issues. There are material shortages or long lead time in for materials that are required for construction. There are also labour shortages, and in some of our key projects, key personnel are now shifting across different organisations. So there are a number of pressures and tensions, I think, around capital spend, which won't just apply to SPS.
I could also come in there. How long does it take to build a prison? You would start off the process of developing the initial design. You would then go out to tender with a contractor, and then you would have a period that can be up to a year developing that design with the contractor, because it's a unique building, you know. And then you're looking at, depending on the complexity of the prison, but I would say you're looking at 2 years plus, you know, for... So, for instance, a large prison, I would say you're looking at 4 years minimum.
Here's the problem, though. If it's not in the current five-year capital investment plan, and it takes at least four years, and these things tend to roll over and go over budget and take longer than people expect for all the reasons you've just mentioned, then you're talking, we're a decade away from having new facilities in Greenock or Dumfries, realistically, given that they're not fit for purpose now. Surely that is why people like the Heart League have such concern.
The Chief Inspector said that she doesn't think they're fit for purpose, and those areas that are of concern are not currently in use, and that's why the condition surveys have been undertaken. So there is investment that will be required both for Greenock and Dumfries over the next 3 years, and we've already scoped out what that investment needs to be, and we will include those proposals in our funding bid for years next year and the year after, and those remedial works should satisfy certainly the Chief Inspector.
We'll save other questions for later if we've got time.
Thanks very much for that. I wonder if I can just come in while we're looking at the issue around prison estates and in particular modernisation, which obviously we've spoken a fair bit about in terms of the capital commitment to that. What I'm quite interested in is looking more at conditions within prisons, so the practical, maybe short-term measures and actions that can be put in place to adapt and improve the conditions within prisons for certain parts of the population. So I'm thinking in particular older people, individuals with disability and so on. So whether that is widening cell doors, whether it's widening or improving access to showers, that type of thing. Now, obviously, I know it's difficult insofar as ultimately we're looking to get to a point where down the line the prison population will be those who pose the sort of greatest risk of harm to society. But we know that with that, there can come challenges in terms of that mix of population. So from a budgetary perspective, I'm just interested in what sort of short to medium term actions can be taken to improve general conditions within prisons, in particular in those that we've highlighted, Jamie Green highlighted, Dumfries and Greenock, for example.
So I'm not sure I'm understanding your question, convener. I'm sorry. You talked about, so are there two parts to the question? One is about accessibility and some of the social care challenges that people experience, and the other is about general condition of buildings?
What I'm interested in is just probably the first part of that is looking at what adaptations can be made in the short term, perhaps to alleviate some of the issues that we know prison staff, healthcare staff face when they're trying to care for people that perhaps have some additional needs in terms of their health, their physical capacity and their general well-being.
Thank you very much, convener. Sorry. I think if I can start probably with something which probably prison does help to an extent with. And so we obviously have got an increasing elderly population, and the numbers of those over 50 has increased quite considerably. I think the Chief Inspector of Prisons quoted figures yesterday of around 46% in our annual report. But certainly from our perspective, we know and understand that people with social care needs don't necessarily sit all within that age group, that it cuts across all age ranges. But there are parts of what we do which support, say, for example, people who have dementia, and we have got people who unfortunately suffer from dementia. The routine of prison actually helps that because the routine gives them a degree of stability that gives them a sense of knowing where they are and who's with them and who's around them. But with other social care needs, we've definitely seen a significant rise. For example, I think the numbers in September, at the end of September, of those who were requiring social care support were in the region of 50. And whilst that may seem like small numbers in a population of 7,500, it nevertheless is quite significant to us as an organisation when we're built prisons for prisons rather than for people with requiring additional supports. But across the prison estate, there are what we call accessible cells in the newer and more recently developed prisons. I think, though, the problem has been that the numbers that require those accessible cells is exceeding the facilities that we have. So what we have undertaken is an assessment of the additional needs, because it can be anything from the the beds which require a greater space round about them for pulleys, etc., just as you see to accessibility for showers. And we do have cells with accessibility to showers. So we do have that across the estate, but what we understand and know from our experience over recent years is that we require to ensure that we have more flexibility and greater capacity. So we have undertaken an assessment. That's obviously been multidisciplinary because we are a prison service, we're not a care service, and we're not a health service. So we've done that in conjunction with other colleagues to ensure that we better understand what we require to have. And at the moment, what we're doing is scoping out exactly where that should be sited, so where we can provide more flexibility in terms of accommodation needs. And then we will determine then what costs are attached to that and how we can best implement that over the next year or so. One of the things I should say is that this is being factored into our thinking, obviously, both for Highland as well as for the new Glasgow.
Thank you very much. That's very helpful. I'll maybe hand over to Pauline McNeill. I know you were interested in looking at the issue around cell occupancy. Before I do that, my clerk's helpfully updated me just going back to the issue around timescales for the construction of prisons. HMP Berlini, I understand, is due to be completed and ready for operation in 2025. Now, that was first looked at, presented to ministers back in 2011. So that's quite a significant timescale, but just to mention that, thought that would be of interest, given that we were looking at that as a very important issue. And Pauline McNeill, I'll just hand on to you.
Thank you for that. It would be helpful to actually get an answer to the convener's question. I did raise this when we were doing the virtual session, just because I represent Glasgow, and it's obviously a really important prison for the west of Scotland, and it just seems so far away. But can I begin by, first of all, just acknowledging, as other members have done, the very serious challenge for the prison service and your staff through the pandemic, and what an amazing job you have done under very difficult circumstances. I think that's really important to acknowledge that. This is a theme that you will know that I'm interested in, which is making progress on the amount of fresh air that prisoners can get out of their cells. Now, obviously, that's been very much restricted through the crisis. But my question is, and I don't need to remind you of the Convention on Human Rights, where every prisoner who's not employed in outdoor work is entitled under that convention to at least 1 hour of suitable exercise in the open air. And I want to make sure that going forward, that, you know, we've heard through questions and answers, and you can't certainly be accountable for all of it, but what we need to make very serious progress, I think, in Scotland to really match up to our obligations under the convention. But my specific question is, what kind of shift in the budget do you think would be required to double the minimum time period that prisoners could get out for more than an hour, so say 2 hours, or to make a significant difference going forward?
Thank you, Ms McNeill. That's a question I hadn't anticipated. One of the things I'd like to reassure you about, first of all, is that in the changes that were made to the prison rules last year to allow us to respond to the pandemic, when we were curtailing the amount of time outside in the fresh air, those regulations were set aside at the end of September, so that we now ensure that everybody does get their hours of exercise. And we were able to do that through the learning that we experienced, because obviously our public health colleagues were very clear about people isolating, but even where we have to isolate people now, we do that in cohorts so that they can still get access to fresh air. So we wouldn't want to be in a position to breach human rights. That is absolutely not where we would want to be, and it felt really, really uncomfortable. not least of which because when people are not able to spend lots of time out with cellular confinement, not having access to that 1 hour is really important, and particularly coming into the winter months, so I share your concerns. Going forward, to allow people to have double access, people can opt in to gymnasium sessions, so everyone's offered access to the gymnasium on a regular basis, depending on where they work and where they're located. And that can be just as important, to have activity that allows people to come together and share in forms of sport and or exercise. But again, there are challenges in that obviously for older people or people with social care needs, you know, those things are not necessarily as accessible. So we have been looking at ways to flex and change what we offer in relation to gymnasium and activity such as that. And we do also, during the summer months, try and extend our offer of outside opportunities to evening arrangements as well, so people can have a second opportunity during the day.
Well, I'm not going to sort of pin you down for anything specific, but just as a general response, what would be your sense of, is it additional staffing or extra additional space, you know, to try and, as you say, gym isn't suitable for everyone. Some of us during the pandemic preferred walking or had to walk. Maybe more people do that now, but getting out in the fresh air, just to be out in the fresh air or to have exercise, is vitally important, and more so for prisoners. What would be your sense of what's required? Is it a staffing issue, a shift issue, a estate issue? Just a general sense of what you where you think we could make changes.
To make those kinds of changes, I think, would require both staffing and estate in terms of having spaces. Traditionally, our prisons have been built with what we call exercise yards, and whilst people do walk around them, they're not particularly pleasant places to walk, if I can say that, and they are large areas. So one of the lessons we have learned from the pandemic has been that prisoners and staff have felt much safer with the smaller cohorts that we've had to establish in order to manage the spread of the virus. So that kind of, arrangement would probably be best supported by more staff and more facilities.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll now move on to issues around purposeful activity. I think Colette Stevenson, you'd like to come in on that, and then after that I'll move back to looking at issues around drugs and bring in Pauline McNeill again. So Colette.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, it's really to touch upon again basically the call from the inspectorate over the review of the provision for purposeful activity. And it's including, you know, its expectation that additional resources, and I mean, you've touched upon the challenges you've faced in terms of absenteeism, and how, you know, really just to see what your thoughts are and where you are with that going forward. So obviously, key to that is delivering a more modern, you know, approach in terms of having the prison estate, you know, with job opportunities for when they do go through their progression as well, and also as well as that is the offending behaviour programmes as well. I know the inspectorate were keen to look at that and review that as well. And I mean, I suppose from a human rights perspective under OPCAT, purposeful activity is key there as well. So I'd just like to see what's happening there, and if you can sort of give me more detail on that.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that question, because I think you've alluded to a modern prison system, and that's certainly where I would like to see the SPS to achieve more in relation to modernisation. And purposeful activity, I think, is at the core of that. I alluded to in my opening statement the fact that we've had to look at how we deliver services through the public health lens. We're acutely aware of the multifaceted health issues that our population have and suffer from. And I think that we know and understand that in order to support people whilst they're in custody, there needs to be a broader range of offer to them, both in relation to health interventions and support, as well as better preparing them for release. Now, that also, though, comes with the context of the current arrangements, and it would be really helpful if somebody could tell me when the pandemic will be over. But, you know, the current arrangements are such that we need to maintain smaller groups of people, keep distancing in place. We are designated as complex settings. But the way to open up opportunities, certainly from my perspective, would be to increase our digital offer, and certainly for me in cell technology, to alleviate some of the pressures that people face whilst they're in custody, allowing them to access services and supports at a time and place when they are ready to do so, and for it to be more self-directed in terms of the individual's choice, I think is definitely for me a more meaningful way to deliver services to those in custody and allow them a greater range and access to supports and services that others experience in communities, but we can't currently consider in prisons because of the restricted nature of what we can deliver.
Okay, in terms of, sorry when you touched upon that, and I'm delighted to hear, obviously, that, you know, you want to move towards a more modern approach. You know, the costs and the budget going forward on that in terms of resources, maybe you could look at, can you tell me a wee bit more about that?
So part of the part of the issue, and Crown Agent alluded to it earlier, I think we are all revising our financial plans and our certainly for SPS, we didn't have a finalised digital plan, and our financial plan also needed to be finalised as well. We need to revisit that in light of the experience that we've had in the last year and a half and of those additional pressures that we're now facing, in order to ensure that all of those pressures that we've experienced and the opportunities that we need to take forward can be properly scoped and accounted for in the budget as we move into future years. So the digital strategy, as was, really focused around much more modest changes. I think we need to be much more ambitious now, and that's certainly where I would anticipate taking our digital strategy in years to come.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, beg your pardon. That's fine, thanks. Yeah, okay, perfect, thank you very much. We'll move, we've just got about 15 minutes left. I'm aware that Rona Mackay has to leave slightly early, so I'll move back to Pauline McNeill in relation to issues around drugs, and then I'll come on to Rona Mackay.
Hey, thank you, Convener. So I won't rehearse all the issues that you've already discussed with other members about the issue of drugs in prisons, but my specific question was that some police officers in Police Scotland have been trained to administer naloxone, and I wondered, has there been any provision made within your staffing, and do you think it's a useful thing for your staff to be trained in? Thanks.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. So we have trained our staff in how to issue naloxone, and naloxone is available in prisons. We also have prisoners who are trained as peer supporters, and people who leave custody are provided with naloxone kits as well. And certainly, anecdotally, I've heard stories from people who unfortunately have come back into prison that they have prevented deaths whilst they've been released due to the naloxone training and equipment that they've been provided with.
Thank you. That's really helpful. I mean, I did note that in virtually all the cases that naloxone has been administered, it has saved lives. So I really welcome that answer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll maybe hand over to Rona Mackay just to look at issues around secure care, and then on over to Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, convener. Thank you. My question, I think, will be with Jerry O'Donnell. It's around funding for secure care facilities for young people. You'll be aware there's a policy move from the Scottish Government that all children under 18 will be held in secure care rather than go to a young offenders institution, Pullman or whatever, and I thoroughly endorse that. The funding model has been causing problems for some time, and the submission from the HM Inspectorate of Prisons for Scotland refers to the importance of secure care being adequately resourced to receive children under the age of 18. It says this will require a different funding model, and at the moment it requires the facilities to maintain full capacity, and spaces are routinely taken by children from England to meet the financial imperative. I know that to be true because I've got a secure care facility in my constituency. So I just wondered what your view was on that. I don't know if you feel you're in a position to comment, but you know, is that something that you are aware of?
Well, first of all, I should say that I've actually only been with the SPS 5 weeks, so
okay.
My knowledge is very limited. Yeah. It might be better if Therese answers this question.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mackay. Yeah, I am aware of the work that's going on just now, and obviously 16 and 17-year-old children being in prison is of concern. Unfortunately, secure care is not my area of expertise, so I wouldn't be able to provide any comment on that. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. I just wanted to put it on record that it is that there is a sea change happening there, and possibly funding could change, but... thank you. Thank you, convener. Okay,
thank you. Ms. Stevenson, would you like to come in on that?
It was really just, I believe there was a review done on children from the Children's Commission as well, as the inspectorate for, you know, in terms of the secure care for children. And obviously they're looking at that long-term strategic review, and I don't know, and I whilst understand, Jerry, you're saying that you've only been in the post for a short time. I mean, this isn't new. This is something that's been raised before within the SPS. Really, is just, you know, what has there been any like reserves or adjustments put in place within the budget? Because of this, or potential change in policy?
Well, what I can say at this point is that we are actually in the process of determining the budget for next year. So we're working with SG on that and identifying a number of initiatives. So this is, obviously, if there's a change in the model, then it would be something we'd consider. But sorry.
I suppose the financial model for secure care doesn't sit with SPS, so unless I'm not understanding your question, I'm really sorry if I don't, Ms. Stevenson. We hold a small number, but nevertheless warning, small number of 16 and 17-year-olds in the prison estate, and they are held at Pullman. The funding model for Pullman, which holds young people and women, is far more generous than for the other parts of the prison estate. But we only have responsibility for the prison estate, not for secure care facilities or for the funding of those facilities.
Okay, so do you know roughly how many are in that age group? How many are being held there in Pullman at the moment?
I can give you the figures as of last Friday. I will have them here, sorry, because I did just look at them recently. The numbers certainly over the last year have been no more than 20. The numbers actually on Tuesday, because I had to provide them, was 17. There were 17 young people under of 16 and 17 year olds.
Fulton, do you want to come in?
Thanks, convener. I think actually my colleague Clay Stevenson has actually probably covered it, because it's in the same sort of area. If you've got 20 young people in this age group who would move into secure care, it strikes me there would be a budget implication for you in a positive sense, if you like, from the prison service. Obviously a positive sense as well, that young people would be in secure care, which I think would be better. Is that something that you would be thinking about in terms of how that budget could be reutilised, or would it stay with Pullman particularly because it's currently a Pullman budget? I do apologise. I think actually when I'd indicated to speak, I think it's very similar to where Colette was going as well.
Thank you for that, Ms McGregor. The funding, although we can provide cost per prisoner place, it's a really complex figure to achieve, because you're talking about staff and resource, the cost and overheads for buildings. So it's very difficult to extrapolate, you know, what would equate to, you know, 16 and 17 year olds and take that out of the budget. So it's not something that we have considered or been asked to do in relation to that. It's really just ensuring that we've got the right services and supports in place to ensure that we provide appropriate care.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. I think, Jamie Green, you want to come in with a final question, and then we'll bring the session to a close.
Thank you, convener. You may need a pen and paper for this one, because I want to ask about a question that we maybe should have covered at the beginning, and that's prison population. I'm quite keen to hear how you forecast the model for that and what those forecasts look like. Now, I appreciate your demand-led service, but the reason I say you might need a pen and paper is because the statistics are quite stark. We've got over 50,000 cases in the courts currently backlogged. We've just heard evidence this morning that adds to that of a 50% increase in indictments over the next 2 years. And we know that 70% of High Court cases relate to quite serious sexual crimes, of which it's natural to assume that non-custodial sentences may not be the outcome for those. Against that backdrop, is it your expectation that the prison population in Scotland is likely to massively increase over the next 5 years? What is your view on that, and by how much do you think it will?
Thank you, Mr Green. I think the figures that the Crown Agent provided this morning clearly are quite stark and are absolutely of concern to SPS. There are a number of areas where we have seen, and Crown Agent again made reference to them, in relation to serious sexual crimes, serious organised crime. And whilst you've, you know, obviously alluded to the fact that not all of those cases will pull through to prisons, clearly a significant proportion of them will. We know that we've had a significant increase in our remand population, and the profile of those on remand suggests that those are the most serious cases. So it is highly likely that those will pull through into our convicted population. Now, the modelling, I haven't taken notes, that I am not an analyst, so I think I would find it difficult. But the modelling that Scottish Government have been trying to undertake has been really challenging, because of the number of different moving parts of the system and the different ways that it can play out. But certainly I would anticipate that we could be heading towards population levels that we saw in 2018-2019. I'm not sure when, and I'm not sure how long that will take to the population will take to rise. But that's certainly where I would anticipate us being in the next few years.
And sorry to push on this, but it's really important from a budget point of view, is that surely as a service, you must have numbers. Because I appreciate there are lots of moving parts, lots of known unknowns, but there are also the knowns, which some of which I've expressed today. We also know the reoffending statistics. We know how many people, for example, end up back in custody within 1, 2, 3, 4 years of leaving custody. So there are trends and statistics that you can pull upon. Now, you have a limited capacity. You have a limited amount of space and a limited amount of people in the system you can hold. So surely there must be some modelling done to know whether you're at some point going to reach that capacity. And then when you do, what happens then? Because that's why that is so important, because we know that we're 10, 15 years away from new prisons in some parts of Scotland. So that's why I'm pushing for the forecasting. Are we going to hit record highs of prison population? And is there physically enough space to accommodate all the people that you are asked to keep under your care?
So how I would answer that, Mr. Green, so the question you initially asked me around the population projections and predictions is something for analysts, and they, what they have indicated, and it's really, this is Scottish Government's area, not mine, but what they have indicated is that the normal trends that we have seen and we normally rely on are no longer relevant in the pandemic world. The world has completely changed, which is why they have found it so difficult to tie down the predictions around likely rise and how long that's likely to take. So, sorry, I can't answer your question, but as I say, I'm told by Scottish Government analysts, that's why it's really difficult. The other question, though, I can answer, and that's around modelling. So we have been... In 2019, there was modelling that was undertaken at that time because of the population pressures, which gives ramp-up figures for where we can increase capacity across the estate. That's quite a complex set of scenarios, but we do have that. However, we have been revisiting that in light of the pandemic, because clearly there are pressures that are placed on us around the continuation of outbreaks. And where we have a reduction in single-cell occupancy, then clearly there are higher risks associated with that. So we are currently looking across the estate to identify ways in which we can increase capacity and identify how we could safely increase the population levels. However, what I would caveat that with is that where in the past we will have increased capacity to accommodate additional population pressures, because of where we are in the pandemic and because of the pressures on reoffending supports and services that have been made available to us, we would require additional investment to ensure that we could support people on their rehabilitative journeys. And that's not something we would necessarily have asked for previously, but would certainly require investment on going forward.
Sort of doesn't answer the question, but I appreciate the reasons why you can't.
I think what may I suggest that in relation to the question around projected population numbers, that might be something you could follow up in writing for us. Okay.
Thank you
very much indeed. So I'm going to draw this session to a close. May I thank you both for coming along today, and obviously if there are additional bits of information that you would care to share with the committee, then please do so in writing. I'd just like to endorse the comments of members today in relation to sort of acknowledging the work that all prison staff have been involved in, particularly during COVID and hopefully coming out of it. We very much appreciate it. So thank you very much for attending today. And that concludes the public part of the meeting. Our next meeting will be on Wednesday, the 10th of November, when we'll complete our pre-budget scrutiny and hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans. Thank you very much.